And all mercies in yours forever. Speak to us now from the witness of your word. Cause us to become transparent enough that your glory may be made manifest. Even as we stand behind this witness box, we remember all of our law enforcement agents and agencies that are being mobilized to provide security. Persons who cannot access the courts of the house of God, but we pray for them that your protective power would be upon them. For your word declares, when you see the blood, you will pass over and not permit the destroyer to enter. And remember the healthcare professionals and others who are a part of essential services. They cannot come to the courts of the house of God. We remember them even now and cause your name to be glorified even in their absence. Cause therefore the words of my mouth, the meditation of our hearts together, to be found acceptable in your sight. For you constantly disclose the divine self as our rock, our strength, and our redeemer. We praise you, we bless you, and we thank you. Amen. To say that this year has been hard and punctuated with difficulties and unexpected loss would be an understatement. For if we were all honest in this house this evening, the story of our painful experiences have been shared already with those close to us. And yet, on a night like tonight, we cannot help but to regurgitate and to retell them, if only in our mind's eye. We do not rehearse the painful stories simply to be awoken or to reawaken a sense or feeling of injustice. Nor do we do this because we want to fan the flames of rage, or simply because we know that we are harboring desires to retaliate or lash out. But rather, we tell our stories because we want to free ourselves from the presence of a God who invites us to exchange our heavy load for his light yoke. Each one of us in this house right now can testify on our own behalf that we have endured and are still enduring some hardness that others without faith will not be able to weather or withstand. The fact is that we stand on the threshold of 2020 as if we are forced to grow up because all of the teen years are done. In fact, we're in Samson from now on. Years will be testified concerning decades. revelation that time is winding up. The fact is, we have experienced the pain of this year, and it is intensifying because all around us there seems to have been chaos after chaos. It seems as if in the rat race of life, people have no time to listen to our pain or problem because everyone was trying to manage or to cope with their own load of care. Even those who asked us how we were doing, they did not stop long enough to hear the answer because they merely asked the question to be polite, not necessarily because they were on our run or wanted to hear our sad story. In fact, this year we met some people who told us, suck it up, bear it like a man or a woman, get tough, because only tough people will laugh. And so most of us, in pain, in silence, we wrestled with God, asking God, what next will happen to us by way of distress or disaster? The fact is, beloved, that some of us have become masters of masking our pain and the problem. So we come in a setting like this, and we pretend as if we have the best marriage and the family in the world. We pretend as if our mortgage is not in crisis. We pretend as if our bills are all paid. We pretend as if our children are wonderful and respectful. We pretend that our siblings and extended family love us unconditionally. We pretend as if our bodies are not diseased, so we paint them up with all sorts of stuff to adorn the outward side, but inside we are dying a slow death because disease is at work in our body. Yet we pretend, Reverend Cox, that all is happy and cheering on our job. We pretend as if we work in a place that is amenable to productivity. We
special song. It was based on six other songs declaring it is the confession of a sin-riddled man. But the modern exegetes have looked again at Psalm 102 and have come to realize that this is not a psalm of confession of sin, but this is a psalm where a man is frustrated and fatigued by the pressures of life. And instead of him going to the word bar, instead of him going looking for dope, instead of him looking for backwood, instead of him looking for a deliver rapper, instead of him looking for a pomegranate or a mango tasted one, he comes into the courts of God and he says in the presence of God, hear my cry, O God, I need you to come and see about me. Is there anybody in Zion tonight who just want to open their mouth and cry unto God and say to God, I don't mind what you're doing for anybody else. I need you to come and look out for me, because trouble is on my heel. Trouble is on my left side. Trouble is on my right side. I wonder if I can find the three persons who have come to that place in their spiritual troubles. Not only is God clearly above your troubles, the text says, but you, O Lord, are in the throne forever. Come by to report that God is in control. He has your circumstance in the palm of his hand. Oh, my sister, my brother, when nobody else is able to help you, you and I serve a God who is in control. He is in control even by the enemy's rage around you. He's in control even though you're getting all sorts of phone calls from the bank. God is still in control. Even though the insurance ain't paid yet, God is still in control. Even though people leave you forsaken, God is still in control. Is there anybody in Zion who understands that God is in control? But not only is God clearly above everything, not only is God in control of everything, God is consistently consistent. He says, you are enthroned forever and forever. My God, in 2020, President Trump may be up for re-election and everybody want him out, but I serve a God who's never up for election. God is God. Can I remind you? Because God is enthroned forever. He's clearly above everything. He is in control. He is consistently consistent. All the arms of flesh will fail you, but there is a God who will never, never, never leave you or forsake you. My soul get a little happy. If God is in control, if God is consistent, and if God is clearly above, I could expect God in 2020 to do some stuff on will rescue you. But that's not all. Not only will he rescue you, when God comes, he will rebuild that which the enemy destroyed and change your destitution. Beloved, can I remind you that when God opens a door, nobody can close it. And when God closes, nobody can open. Is there anybody in here? The enemy and shiny dreams have already tampered with your state of mind. But I'm glad to report that when God in Christ comes, he will reveal that which has been torn down. Somebody say, I wonder.
the psalmist said,